let's just have a look back very briefly as to how does medical imaging occur today? What is the foundational elements or aspects of it? So firstly, we'd all be familiar with CT and MRI. They're the gold standards by which imaging at the highest level is actually achieved. And they're very large, they're very expensive, they're limited in their availability to patients, and they're usually inaccessible immediately to patients, for example, critically ill patients in hospitals. Now, we've developed, and this technology has been in development for 10 years at the University of Queensland, so there's a substantial background. We haven't just leapt into this ourselves, but we're developing a technology which is able to scan the brain. Now, why are we going through a more complex or interesting process for doing that? Well, the transformational modality for point of care imaging has really been ultrasound. Again, we're familiar with ultrasound, everything from fetal maternal monitoring all the way through to muscular changes through to liver and even cardiovascular approaches. Now, one of the real challenges that we have with looking at the brain is that sound or ultrasound is unable to penetrate the brain because of the thick bony structure called the skull. So the EM technology, which is the foundational technology which we use, has the capability of penetrating the skull into the soft tissue and deep into the soft tissue of the brain to identify pathologies, which today there is no portable way to do. Now, one of the exciting parts about what we're doing is it's non-ionizing radiation. So CT is gamma rays, which can be toxic over the longer time. The energy that we're applying to the brain is a fraction of what you would have in your iPhone, and it's extremely fast. So we have data acquisition in 3 seconds and image reconstruction in 30 seconds. If you compare that to a CT, for example, you're looking at 20 minutes being stuck in a high radiation facility. So it's very safe, it's portable. And you can see on the left-hand side, which is our next generation product, where it's smaller in many cases of a standard ultrasound, and it's easily accessible. So you can move it around ICU wards, you can move it around and between hospital beds. Now, I'll talk about why this is a really important modality and why the brain is particularly valuable. But fundamentally, we're going to talk about stroke, which is one of the largest killers on the planet for people around the world. So this is going to be a video, short video of our early prototype, and you'll see it's clunkier than the one you see on the left, but the enormous learnings that we've actually obtained through our hospital clinical trials has allowed us to move to this version that we see on the left-hand side. So here's the video. So the device is approximately 5 foot tall, which is just a little shorter than myself. And you can see that there is a user interface, which is very simple. It's a simple computer screen, and all the measurement is actually going to be done on a computer. So you don't need intense computer power that you would, say, in a device like an MRI. So there's the scanner that goes on the head. It's lightweight, relatively, and this is David Cook moving this into a simulated room, and you can see the headset being placed on the patient. Now, the fundamental technology works with an array of antennas, and these antennas send EM information out into the brain. They also receive the information. In the belly of the device, you can see there in the clinical prototype, there is a measurement a device which then sends the calculated information back to a computer where you can actually see an image. So that's essentially the way that it works, and you can kind of think of it as a radar type process. So why are we looking at stroke? Well, stroke is an enormous problem. There is no portable way to be able to investigate at a point of care. You can imagine a sick stroke patient in an ICU ward. If you want to be able to go and image progress of their stroke, you have to take them to a CT or MRI. We can do that continuously by the bedside. Stroke is an enormous healthcare burden. Two-thirds of stroke survivors will suffer some form of permanent disability. In the United States, it's a $90 billion per annum healthcare economic problem. And we have to remember, for those of us who've had loved ones and family who've had stroke, is that rehabilitation and long-term impact is a real issue to families and society. So one of the critical things about imaging is no point just imaging things for the sake of it. You actually need to be able to intervene. So the doctors have to provide a solution or to be able to have an effective clinical process that they can actually deploy. And there are, first of all, there are two types of strokes. There's an ischemic stroke, and you can see at the bottom of the screen, MRI, you can see the white patch or contrast is actually the ischemic stroke. That is a blockage. It's a blockage of a blood vessel, and that prevents oxygen going to the parts of the brain and causes brain death. The other one, which is actually more dramatic in the speed, is something called a hemorrhagic or a bleed. So you've got a clot and a bleed. The bleed is a ruptured vessel. The bleed contacts the brain. It's extremely toxic to the brain, and it can actually cause significant damage. Now, we have a two-pronged approach to developing our technology and to moving it into two separate point of care areas. Now, our first device is going to be working in the hospital. It will be able to provide clinical information as to the development of stroke for stroke patients that have already been admitted. One of the big issues with stroke patients is that interventional radiologists that have actually gone in to actually pull the clot out can actually result in a bleed. Now, also patients who've received a clot-busting drug will also potentially have a bleed after they've been admitted to the hospital. And it's really important to know that if you give a clot-busting drug to someone with a bleed, that can make the bleed worse. You can actually kill them. So understanding the status of the stroke is absolutely critical, whether it's in the bedside or where our second generation is going to be, which is a highly portable, lightweight device that we're looking to put in the back of an ambulance, which fundamentally works much like an AED, or as was early known as the Packawacker for people who are of my generation. So we've been extremely fortunate to very recently in the last few weeks receive strong approbation and support from the Australian government by the receipt of $8 million of non-dilutive stage funding. And I do want to point out that there is no one-to-one requirement for us to actually contribute to the $8 million. It's part of the Australian Stroke Alliance collaboration, which is a consortium led by Melbourne Hospital, with two of the most eminent stroke urologists in the country, and one could argue some of the most in the world, to bring together, I guess, an alliance of people who are able to work, such as paramedics and flying doctor, to bring the best diagnosis and treatment to patients, not only in the urban areas, but also in rural and indigenous countries. It's one of the largest grants that have actually been applied, and we're very fortunate to be able to receive it. Now, one of the real advantages that we have as a result of this funding is that it not only goes into our second generation device, and you can see the way it can be deployed in an ambulance, how small it is, how it can be put onto a wall of the device, but it does also fund to a large extent our early clinical pivotal trials with our hospital device. So there is a front end weighting of some of that remuneration that we're going to receive, which I think is going to have a dramatic impact on our ability to do the best clinical trials that we can possibly do under the circumstances, which is actually very exciting. So let's go back to the first part of clinical study. So we're not just talking about a device that is imaginative, we're talking about something that has been applied to stroke patients. Just to give you a little bit of background of the trial, it's a non-interventional stroke trial, which means that patients would come in, we in no way interfered with their protocol, with their treatment, and then patients were scanned with Envision's device as close as we possibly could to the standard of care, which was CT or MRI. So keeping in mind that we didn't interfere. We had 30 patients enrolled. The majority of those were patients with blockages, and the mean age was 67. So they weren't extremely old. There were some younger patients in their 40s and 50s. And I think one of the really important parts is there's the NIHSS score, which is the American National Institute of Health stroke standard for differentiating and classifying strokes. Now you can go from 0 to 40. 40 is severe morbidity. 0 is very minor. It might be a transient ischemic attack. And we're at 5.2. So 5.2 is a low to moderate type of stroke that the patient had, which is really important because it goes to the veracity and the credibility of the data that I'm going to show you just in a minute. So originally our primary endpoint was to be able to learn about the EM technology as it applies to our patients for stroke and to be able to advance our imaging methodologies. But as you'll see, we've got some outstanding data that has provided us with results, which I'll talk about very soon. So here is some of the exciting data that we were able to obtain. I'll try and take you through this as fast as reasonable. If you have a look at the left-hand side of both sides of the images, you'll see some gray images. That is an MRI, and you can see where the circles are. They identify where the strokes are. On the left-hand side, on the ischemic strokes or the blockages, you can see a white patch, and that identifies where the blockage is. Now, in the center of the panel is essentially a one-stop shop fusion of the algorithms that we have, the mathematical reconstruction of images that remarkably and quite beautifully align with the location of the stroke. Not only that, please keep in mind we're looking at electrochemical, so electrical properties of tissue, which is a completely new way of looking at the way tissue is behaving in response to tissue damage. There's extremely high contrast. You can see down the middle panel the correlation. And one of the other important things is that we're able to classify. So if you look at the third panel on the left-hand side, you can see the blue dots, again, which align with the stroke. But the really important point, which goes to the treatment modalities and interventions about, say, the blood thinning agents for clots, is you're able to distinguish between a bleed and a hemorrhage. Really important, distinguishing between a bleed and a hemorrhage, which is what's really important if you've got the patient in an ambulance. On the right-hand side, you've got exactly the same type of layout. If we go to the middle, you can see the strong alignment with the MRI images. And of course, on the right-hand side, each one of those patients has been able to be discriminated from as hemorrhagic from the ischemic on the left-hand side of the panel. So now let's talk about some of the outcomes in a minute. Now, I'm really excited about this. So you guys are the first to be able to see this. And my colleague, Scott, who I can see on my screen, is smiling at me at the moment because I think when we originally spoke about earlier on is that we weren't looking to generate anatomical information that would sort of replicate the types of data that you might get from an MRI. So if you look on the left-hand side, this is a patient that will de-identify as patient 9. You can see an MRI image. This is what we call a horizontal slice of the brain. And what I'm going to show you is an electric reconstruction of the tissue that is very representative of the type of image that you have on the left-hand side that provides you with a lot more type of information than you can get just by, well, rather, let's say not a lot more, but a different type of information that you can get with MR and CT. Now, if you look at starting from the very outside, you can see a pale greenish-yellow area, and that is the bladder that we use inside the headset to make it fit appropriately to the different sizes of heads. And as you go through, you can see the skull, you can see the skin, you can see the skull, you can see white matter, which is deeper tissue inside the brain. You can see gray matter, which is closer to the skull. And the very bright yellow that you see in the center are the ventricles where the cerebral spinal fluid is. So we're getting really good anatomical detail at the electrical level, which is different to the modalities anywhere in the world. So this is very much a world first that you're seeing here. So when we look at the outcome of that pilot trial, we got some great results. From the 30 patients, we had 93-96% accuracy for subtype classification. We had 86-96% localization accuracy, and we had very positive feedback from patients and operators. So we've been quite excited about those results, and certainly does very strongly set us up for the future trials that we're going to undertake. And it also sets us up, which I'll talk in a minute, with potential commercial partners who have been very impressed with the data that we've acquired today. So giving you a sense of our clinic over our CY 2021, what our target milestones are, obviously we're going to continue to aggressively develop our next clinical prototype, and our clinical trial, which is a large one, is slated to begin at the end of 2021. So we're punching ahead as fast as we can. And it is worth noting at this stage, we haven't missed a milestone that we presented to the market. So I think that's unusual in our sector. We are going to look at an extra 20 patients to build up on the original 30 patients. We're going to have a look at a slightly different sets of protocols. And again, that's going to feed into the direction that we're taking. Now, we've been very clear that we wanted to engage with regulators as early as possible. One of the big mistakes that medical and biomedical companies make is that they don't start engaging with their major stakeholder, which is the FDA or the TGA or any other regulatory body. We have an outstanding head of regulatory, who I'll introduce in a minute, who has engaged with the FDA, and we've put in an application called the 513G, which essentially has indicated to us the pathway that we're taking, which is actually going to be a 510K de novo. So it gives us real clarity as to what it is that we need to do. Now, on top of that, in the next couple of weeks, we're looking to apply for something called an FDA breakthrough application. Now, this is a very exciting, relatively new program that the FDA has initiated, which allows companies such as us to present breakthrough technology in order to accelerate the process of evaluation. But very, very importantly, provides a four-year opportunity for reimbursement. And as we all understand, reimbursement is critical for us to be able to generate revenue, but also mitigate costs for payers downstream. So that opportunity is fantastic. We strongly believe that we have a life-saving product that will actually revolutionize the way stroke treatment is occurring. And we certainly feel encouraged that we're in a good position to be able to receive that, but also being aware that the FDA has its own processes. We're in strong discussions on a continual basis, again, even though it's early stage, with commercial and collaboration partners, and we've had multiple conversations, and we've had incoming and obviously outgoing discussions, which again points to the commercial advantage and the fact that companies do not have products such as ours in their portfolio. So let's just go for a moment to our ambulance version. Now, the Australian Stroke Alliance has done something outstanding, which is set up with Steve Davies and Jeff Donnan, have actually set up a stroke ambulance, which operates within a 20 kilometre radius of Royal Melbourne Hospital. Now, to give you a little bit of sense of this particular ambulance, it is a purpose-built ambulance with a 600 kilogram CT that costs $1.5 million to outfit. It's not scalable. There are 30 sites around the world that are testing this particular approach. But to give you a sense of the ability to achieve remarkable outcomes in that first golden hour. So that first golden hour is the hour in which the most dramatic amount of brain can be saved, because time is brain in stroke. And what the ambulance has been able to achieve is a reduction in time to patients in Ford by 41%, right? That is really remarkable. And it's treated 10 times as many patients as you would with a paramedic process. And the outcomes in longer term are quite amazing. Jeff Donnan has shared with us that some patients go to the hospital, and because of the rapidity in which they've been diagnosed and intervened, they can walk out the next day. That is absolutely a fascinating outcome. And it really proves the fundamentals of what we're trying to achieve in the ambulance. But imagine now the ability to put this in every ambulance, to be able to have this in regional areas where there is real concerns about access to what we call...
Ron, I'm just going to have to jump in for a minute because we're getting very close to the end of the session. I'm going to ask the technicians to please extend this session so that we can get some questions in at the end, but we might ask you to wrap up the presentation fairly quickly, if that's okay, and so we get some time for questions. We've got a few good questions coming through.
Absolutely, Ajita. I think you'll get the point about the stroke ambulance. I do want to just go to the revenue models. We do have a consumable strategy with a cap which will be used at every use of which the patient is scanned, and which gives us substantial margin. And that's the normal device sale process, software and maintenance, which is about 14%. And we have something which is a monthly subscription model, which is very popular in the United States because of its ability to be easily implemented through the financial system. We have a 10,200 total addressable market for our hospital device in the United States. And when we're pricing this at around $150,000, you get a sense that it's not just capital equipment, but a long-term consumable revenue. Great team, Stuart Crozier, key inventor of the technology, but also contributor to MRI technology and patents around the world. Great regulatory person with Ruth, who's had international regulatory exposure from Nanosonics, I've pinched too. And my right-hand person in punching through product, who's been at the foundation of new product development at Nanosonics and future product development.